from the domestiques. On other occasions, the team leader himself might find he's got to work with the group. In this case here, as it was last year, Pedro Delgado was in trouble in the team time trial, and the team were obliged to slow down and wait for him. There's no point in leaving behind the team leader, because realistically, he's the only man who can win the Tour de France for them. He's not just good at time trialing, he can climb mountains as well.
And the 22 teams in the Tour de France today, which start 4 minutes apart in the 44.5 kilometres team time trial, are going to need all of their skill and intelligence to avoid the crosswinds which are ripping across the course today. And it's over the very exposed roads out and about Futuroscope. Until the team time trial, the riders will need plenty of shelter. This is the arrival of the Wyman team, completing their 44.5 kilometer circuit of Futuroscope. And the Wyman team, led by Adrie van der Poel, are going to come very close to the best time so far. The Aliostia team from Italy is going to be very close. They're given the same time. The clock says they're number one. They must have beaten Aliostia by fractions of a second right on the line. So the Wyman team, led by their team leader Adrie van der Poel and the former Belgian champion Carlo Bomans, are in. We're out on the course again now, and the gale force conditions are persisting, and you can see the formation here indicating the wind at the moment coming from around 1 o'clock, the top right hand corner of our screen, as the riders try to take diagonal shelter. And there's a very good description of that, the wind blowing from the right shoulders of the rider. And the boys at the back of the Benesto team, Paul, are hanging on in there by the look of it.
Well, it's very difficult to hang on, especially when you get to this stage of the game. The riders have done their turn at the front, they're stripping back a little bit. And when a rider can't keep his wheel on the wheel in front of him, he has to try and get into the gap to bridge the gap for his teammate. Here you can see at the back here, one of the riders having a really hard time trying to get back on. It looks like Javier Luca is really suffering. He keeps leaving a gap while the other rider is coming from the front, and he'll try and get into the line again.
Well, this of course is Pedro Delgado's team, and if you were watching with us a year ago, you can remember the disastrous start that Delgado had. Not only did he lose time in the prologue time trial, Lurkamp by the way is going off here, but Delgado also lost time in the team time trial. He was in fact in the position that this man is in, Lurkamp, last year, when Delgado was dangling off the back and the team were told to wait for him. Well, they won't wait for Javier Lurquin. I'm afraid he's one of the domestiques of the team. He will be slipping away now. He may have given a lot of effort early on, and now it's all over for him. But not only is the time for the ride taken on the fifth rider to cross the line, therefore five riders at least must be together, because you're only as strong as the fifth man in the race. That's when the clock will stop, not on the other four riders. It means the team must stay together at least five strong. So Lurquin is dropped off the back. But apart from that, the Benesto team look to me as though they're going pretty well. Look at that gap already. There's the formation. All of the riders using these disc wheels, which I would have thought today, Paul, especially in these winds, they're rather difficult to keep the bike steady.
Well, it's not too much of a problem when they're using them in the rear, because the big problem in these crosswinds is when they try and use two discs, one on the front wheel, because with the crosswinds you have a great deal of difficulty steering the front end of the bike.
There's Dominique Arnaud, the only Frenchman on this virtually all-Spanish team. Benesto, by the way, is a Spanish bank. And number 21 is the number of Delgado. All of the team leaders carry one on the number. Sitting at the back here, Abelardo Rondon, who's the only Colombian rider in this Spanish setup. At least they'll speak the same language.
Yeah, but you can see the team of Delgado here is a very drilled squad. They've got a one big long line across the road, and then Arno has just left a gap for the rider who's come from the front to slip in there. Arno has obviously put a lot of effort into this move earlier on, and he's trying to recuperate a little bit. So the rider who's just done his turn will drift down in the shelter and get back into his place, and they'll carry on again.
These conditions really are difficult today. They are very, very strong. The wind is blowing, in fact, straight into our commentary position. So if I sound a little bit muffled, it's because the wind in here is blowing everything just about everywhere. Nice position as the riders are being pulled through. It looks like it could be Miguel Indurain at the front now as he turns on the power and drags the line out, and they're scrabbling for the wheels at the back. Look. Rondon is in trouble at the back of this line. We've just seen Lurquin slip away. It looks like Rondon might be the next. The pressure is now telling. This the little men, they come out in these time trials. They have to give their all. That's all the team leader will expect from them. He'll expect 100% effort as long as they can give it. And when they can't give 100%, they should sit at the back and stay out of the way or drop off. Now we're back to the finishing line. This is the arrival now of Chateau Dax with two East German riders on the line. The clock, don't forget, stopping on the fifth man to go over the line. The time to beat is Ariostia, 54 minutes and 42 seconds. And that is the same time, indeed, that Wyman have also recorded in their finish. But Chateau Dax, a little bit out of it, they finished with their full counters there, five men over the line, and they've got second best time, 55-14. Well, I think that's a mistake, because we've already seen Wyman come in with a better time. So as we wander on our helicopter now to pick up the next team, you get some idea of the agricultural countryside here in the department of the Anne. And they say that is why they originally thought of the idea of building Futuroscope, to try and attract more business to this mainly farming area. And the Tour de France, especially the riders, will be rather glad to go away, I think, because of these winds, which weren't expected. The day before the Tour started, the temperatures were 80 plus degrees, and the riders are enjoying every minute of it. So, Binesto team, they're approaching the finish, but they're still some little way out on the course, in fact, because the next team that should come in will be the one we're waiting for, especially after this morning's performance, because it's Steve Bauer's 7-Eleven squad, the rider in the yellow jersey. The time, and it's a little bit complicated, I'll explain it to you as carefully as I can. The time, as I say, is taken on the fifth rider across the finishing line, but the time goes to each rider's individual standing in the race, which means that Bauer, with a 2-second lead over Van Massen, his team must beat the Buckler team by 2 seconds, or rather Massen's team must beat Bauer's team by 2 seconds, and the yellow jersey will go across to Van Massen. We're looking at the situation here after 20 kilometers. Wyman with the best time there, but they're in now, and the time is almost equal to the best time. TVM, Phil Anderson's team, has gone through now, 3 seconds down. But Chiapucci's Carrera team, he was the rider who has now come into the overall reckoning in third place after that breakaway this morning. And that's interesting, actually, Paul, to see that Chiapucci's team has pulled out a good one so far.
They've always done good time trials in the past, especially when Stephen Roach used to ride for them, and probably motivated by the fact that Chiapucci was in that front group this morning and stands a chance of taking the yellow jersey. They've really lifted themselves to this occasion.
With now Phil Anderson's team, with Phil Anderson indeed, number 161 at the back of the line. The fact that Anderson is here keeping the team going means the whole line is going, as they say, through and off. The lead will take the race through, swing over to the right into the wind. And up on the lee side of the wind comes the next rider. Back to the finish. This is 7-Eleven. And Steve Bauer is in this group of riders here. 54-42 is Wyman's time at the moment. And they've confirmed now that Wyman are the new leaders. But 7-Eleven are coming up. And this is a very good time indeed by the 7-Eleven team. And Bauer, in the centre left of our picture, is bringing them home. So Steve Bauer is not going to give up easily that new found yellow jersey. 54-12. Steve Bauer comes over the line. And with him leading there was Ron Kiefel, the former champion of America. 54 minutes, 12 seconds then. 7-Eleven can't ask for more than that at this point. They are the best time of the day. But of course, the teams who specialize in the team time trial, the people like Binesto, Buckler, Stephen Roach's Histor team, Castorama Rally and PDM, have still to come home. Out again with Phil Anderson. This is the situation when the riders came through the 36-kilometer point. 7-Eleven set the best time then. They are now home with the best time of the moment. Ariostia were second, Wyman were third. They are the top three teams on the finishing line at the moment. 7-Eleven, Wyman, and Ariostia is the order on the finishing board. Again, Carrera coming good in fourth place, because the Carrera team is not a particularly strong team time trial team since Stephen Roach left the team a couple of years ago. And Chiapucci, who was in with a real shot at winning Paris-Nice this year, lost his high position because of a bad team time trial. Some people say it's unfair to include a team time trial and then put the times to the individual riders' classification, because after all, you're only as strong as your team. Others say, well, the Tour de France, like all multi-day races, are team races, and you should be as strong as your team, and your team should be as strong as you. But it certainly picks out the weak riders in the squad. A lot of work being done here. The riders clearly going into the wind here. They're having to work out of the saddle. Once they swing and pick up the wind behind them, they'll be coming those low crouch styles. And I would think in this wind today, Paul, once they turn with the wind, they're going to do something like 65, 70 kilometres an hour.
Well, it's very fast to the finish, with this, especially with this tailwind on the way in here. They will be doing that sort of speed, something around about 40 miles an hour. You can see here, they've got a fantastic line straight across the road here. There's a rider at the back starting to suffer a little bit. That was Jacobs, actually, who was forced into the team on the request of Phil Anderson. He said he wouldn't ride the Tour de France unless his teammate was included in this squad, and it looks as if he's suffering at the moment, so the team director's not going to be too pleased with the fact that he's been forced into the team by Anderson.
So there he is at the back, Patrick Jacobs, number 164. And you see, he's allowed that little gap to open. Once the elastic snaps, you're blown away. And his head's going up and down. If we could see his face, it would be a picture of pain. Of that, I am quite certain. Jan Siemens is number 168, just in front of Jacobs. Now you can see the smooth line working at the front. The rider's keeping tight formation. They'll ride about 100 metres on the front, then he'll slightly ease the pressure. Very often the riders flick their left elbow out, which is the indication to the man behind that he should now begin his pass. And here's the Carrera team. This is the team, of course, that Chiappucci is on, and has now been accelerated into the top rider in that team after that long, long breakaway this morning that gained over 10 minutes. There he is. Where's 171, the leader of the team? And I think he'll pick up some strong support here from people like Acacio da Silva, number 173, the first yellow jersey in the Tour de France last year when the racing started proper in Luxembourg. If you remember, Eric Breuking of Holland won the prologue, and then Acacio da Silva broke away in Luxembourg and became the race leader for quite a few days. He's in the team here now, playing the role of domestique. There's Girotto, another strong one. Again, the gap's forming in this team as well. The wind is bad enough, but of course, when you've ridden an almost four-hour race this morning, and then you've got to come out to do it all again, then of course, it makes it that little bit harder. Chiappucci sitting at the back, seemingly happy enough. He's also the leader in the King of the Mountains competition. There's a couple of small climbs this morning. He scored best, and so he's the leader of the King of the Mountains, for the time being at least. That was also a competition he won in Paris-Nice at the beginning of the year. Here come the Carrera then, up towards the line. They've lost a few seconds to 7-11, so Steve Bauer is gaining time over Chiappucci, pushing him further away. 54-53 is the time for Carrera. As they take, at the moment, fourth place. It's a good show of defiance by Claudio Chiappucci, is that? He was 9 seconds behind Steve Bauer this morning, after this morning's race. He's lost a few more seconds now. One or two, and I mean just one or two, of the 900 pressmen we saw there on the finishing line, waiting to see just if there will be a challenge later on from Jan Rati's buckler team. Looking here at Helvetia Lasmith, Henri Manders sitting at the back, who came into this race at the very last minute. He didn't expect to be riding the Tour de France this week. And you can see now the new style technology involved in cycling. We used to call these the funny bikes, when Cyril Guimard brought along a bicycle with a sloping forward top tube, which looked rather like one of the old-fashioned butcher's meat bikes, and he asked the press to give it a name, and he had a competition, and the winner received one of the bikes as a prize, and somebody said, call it Le Profil, the profile bike, and that's how it all started. And Guimard, of course, all of the ideas now copied and built on, and the result is they all ride these very strange bikes that give them a much better aerodynamic position.
This is a well-drilled squad here from Paul Koestli, the Helvetia La Suisse team. He's very, very meticulous in his preparation of this kind of event, but at the moment they don't really seem to have the motivation of the team that they had last year when Steve Bauer was riding with them, and it must have been quite a shock to their morale when Steve Bauer jumped away this morning and took the yellow jersey.
In fact, Paul Koestli, the manager of this team, was very sorry when Steve Bauer had to leave him. He simply couldn't afford to pay Bauer the salary he'd been offered by the 7-Eleven squad, which is reported to be over $500,000. Situation here at 20 kilometres. Panasonic has now gone on top at 20 kilometres, 23 minutes 34 seconds. Zed, Reglemond's team, and Ronan Pensex now, 9 seconds slower. And out of the top five have gone the 7-Eleven. That won't be too serious at this minute, but he could well see Pensek coming into the yellow jersey, Paul, by the end.
Well, the Z team have always put in good performances in the team time trials over the last few years. They've always been there third, fourth, fifth position. But with the fact that this year they have Greg LeMond in the team, and the fact that today Ronan Pensek could take the yellow jersey, well, that's going to be a very big boost to their ego, and they'll probably come up with a good performance. Panasonic, obviously, getting back to the form that they had a long time ago as the unbeatable team in team time trials, leading at the moment.
Ronan Pensek has started this afternoon's time trial, 21 seconds behind Steve Bauer overall. And he's already recuperated that time at 20 kilometres covered. So if progress continues, Steve Bauer will lose his yellow jersey to Ronan Pensek. But don't forget, of course, behind Pensek's Z team, we still have to see the buffer team of Franz Matten. Here's the RMO squad. 54 minutes, 32 seconds and counting. 7-Eleven are still on the leaderboard, but we're now being seen by the indication at 20 kilometres. They won't be there too much longer. The RMO team are coming home. And the fact that this close to 7-Eleven indicates that 7-Eleven's time will not survive to the end of this race today.
Now, this place is billed as the city of the 21st century, which is quite apt, really, because that's when large parts of it are due to be finished. And with no disrespect to what's actually quite a successful tourist attraction, you might wonder why the organisers of the Tour de France, with the whole of the country to choose from, decided to start the race at a theme park outside Poitiers. Well, the answer's quite simple. Money.
5 million francs, or over £500,000, is the going rate for putting your town on the tour map these days. That's 10 times what Futuroscope paid last year simply to host a stage. In return, it gets 3,500 weekend guests in the shape of the race entourage and instant fame by association as the location of hundreds of radio, television and newspaper reports. Not least, it also attracts the public, who come for the race, which is free, of course, but can usually be persuaded to spend a few francs on other entertainment along the way.
By the time the tour rolls out of here for the next stage in Poitiers, Futuroscope will have raised its public profile perhaps a thousandfold. And despite the cost, towns all along the route over the next 22 days are queuing up to do the same. Perhaps the only group of people unaffected by the hype and ballyhoo are the riders. To them, the towns could scarcely matter less, only the stretches in between. And for the latest on today's stage, let's rejoin Phil.
And this is the team we've been waiting to see, the arrival of the Z team, led by the world champion in the centre there, Greg LeMond. The time they need to do to take the yellow jersey from Steve Bauer is 53 minutes and 50 seconds. That has gone by. Steve Bauer has survived at least Ronan Pensek's challenge, because they come home with 54 minutes and 17 seconds for second place for the Z team. And in fact, out on the course, the Z team were ahead of 7-Eleven, and it does seem, Paul, that the 7-Eleven have done a superb ride over the closing kilometres.
Well, they have, but I think the Z team themselves had to slow down a little bit because Pensek was in a lot of trouble there, and they probably had to slow down and wait for him. They couldn't let him drop off because he was one of the riders who could keep in the yellow jersey for the first 10 days of this Tour de France.
So the Benesto team, by the way, with Pedro Delgado on, they have come in with a time of 55 minutes and 22 seconds. So they have lost almost a minute there, Pedro Delgado to Greg LeMond. That's at least a big slice of good news for Greg in his early stages of the Tour de France, because although we're seeing a strange Tour de France today with four unusual riders, I'll call them, at the top of the classification after this morning's run, the big leaders will be comparing each other as well during this afternoon's team time trial. We still have six teams to come, and among them, of course, the Buckler team with Frans Madsen. And Madsen starting this afternoon just 2 seconds behind Steve Bauer. So if his team comes home with a time more than 2 seconds better than what 7-Eleven have recorded, then Madsen will be the rider in yellow tonight. Well, Bauer survived a big push from Zed, because of all the checks, Zed were ahead of 7-Eleven. And this could also provide something of a surprise in the result, Paul, the Once team from Spain, because they've been coming through the checks challenging Panasonic.
Well, they've had a very good year as well. This is one of the richest teams in Spain, if not one of the richest teams in the world at the moment. They're sponsored by the charity for the blind in Spain. They've got some good time trialists in there.
And they've also got, by the look of it, Paul, the whole team still in this formation. The teams have been coming into the finish here completely split up. They've got to finish five men, of course. No good coming home with four, because the time will not stop till the fifth man arrives. Here's the situation now at 36 kilometres. Panasonic leading all the way through the checks, 46 minutes, 53 seconds. Once on our screen now, they're through there in second place. 7-Eleven, though, are now up to third here, because earlier on the checks, the other teams have gone over them and pushed them right off the leaderboard. But they quite clearly have finished very, very strong indeed. That says a lot for Steve Bauer after that long, hard breakaway this morning, in virtually the same conditions that we're getting here this afternoon. Gale force winds, and as strong a wind as I can recall in the Tour de France for many years. Here's the Panasonic coming in. 7-Eleven is the team to beat with 54-12. Panasonic should do this, but they're not stealing a lot of time back, and they certainly have nobody here that will challenge now for the yellow jersey above, because there was nobody from this team in the leading move this morning. A Panasonic 53-24, and I think that will be the time now that everybody must aim for the rest of the day, because that is the Panasonic team at their very best. They used to be the kings of the team time trial in the days when the TI Rally sponsored them in Britain, and they had such great riders on the squad as Jerry Kadettaman and Jan Raas. Jan Raas here in a very different role now as manager of the Buckler team, and a great rival of Peter Post, who still manages the Panasonic squad, by the way. And if Buckler, and here we are now on screen, if Buckler can just get Madsen up here today to bip 7-Eleven on the line, and then they'll have the first yellow jersey that they've had in that team. So it's a brand new team. Now, what do you think, Paul? There's a lot of action going on here, and there's plenty at the front of the team. The boys at the back are struggling.
Well, they are doing, but it's a very difficult thing, this team time trial, especially the last few kilometres here. The wind is very, very strong, and a rider who's done his turn at the front, if he misses getting onto the wheel, it's very difficult to bridge the gap. You see one of the riders here sat up. In fact, it looks as if it's
I think it's Twan Poels who's gone.
Gerrit de Vries,
it was, who's just slipped through the way. And when you go quickly.
But once you lose the gap there, you can't get back onto the wheel, so you might as well just sit up and get into the finish as easily as possible.
So they've lost the man as they come towards the end. Again, a check of the situation at the finish line now. Panasonic lead, 7-Eleven are second, and Zed with Greg LeMond are third. So at this minute in time, no change in the overall position as we come towards the end of the team time trial section. Steve Bauer is still the race leader. This is Edwig van Hooijdonk, the early leader of the Perrier World Cup last year, who's sitting at the back of the group. He put in a great bid to win the Belgian Championship the weekend before this tour started. He didn't quite catch up with Claude Coquillon, who won the title down in the Belgian Ardennes by Liège. Well, I bet he wishes he had some of that same form right now, because he looks to be struggling, and he's the team's leader, Paul.
Well, he's probably put a lot of energy into trying to get this yellow jersey, because for a team like Buckler, who don't stand a chance of winning overall in the Tour de France, they want as much publicity as they can get out of it. So all the riders will have given their maximum, because they only need to beat the 7-11 team by 2 seconds to put Frans Madsen on the top of the leaderboard. They've got back together here now. They're very compact again. Maybe Van Hooijdonk was just having a little bit of a hard time there. As you can see in the green jersey, there's Frans Madsen at the moment, leader of the points classification. Tonight he'd love to put that yellow tunic on.
Well, I'm sure before the Tour de France started, he never dreamt of doing that. Jan Ross read the move correctly this morning. He says he can't understand why the break succeeded by so much, but it happens on these short stages, is what he thinks. And as soon as the gap opened, the instruction was go as long and as fast as you can and see what happens. And the answer was, of course, more than 10 minutes gain at the finish. And it's probably going to shape the Tour de France for the next 5 or 6 days. And there is Frans Madsen rushing to the front of the line as quickly as he can. 2 seconds is all he's thinking about. Although we can't see him, Jan Ross is driving the car 25 metres behind this team, screaming his head off.
Well, you can almost see the speed of the riders here. For one of the lads at the front there, just having a quick drink, not forgetting all the time they've had a hard ride this morning. It's very easy to blow up when you have two stages in the one day, and he's just getting a little bit more energy into himself there. Look at the speed there as the riders go through again. The rider in the second place there didn't have much time to recover. He's done his turn. As we go back to the front here, Anse coming in with a good time, but not as good as the Panasonic time.
It could still take second place, Paul, because Anse have done a great ride here. Steve Hodge, the Australian, having his best season, finished high up in the Tour of Italy. And he's happy in this team. He's bringing them home now, and they're coming up to the line a little bit away from Panasonic, but nonetheless should be okay for second. 53-46, a very, very good performance indeed by Anse, and a challenge from an unexpected quarter there. But it's good to see Stephen Roach anxious to drive this team on. It's proving he has got some fitness in those legs now. He was quick to fall back in halfway down that line, because once a rider senses that the man behind him is beginning to suffer, they immediately take their position early in the line and go back up to the front to set the pace. They don't wait for the weak men to come by them at all. And in fact, they get very annoyed if they try to come by them. They want them to stay out of the way. Kilometer 36 then, back down the course. This was the situation. But no real news here. Panasonic, as they have done all the way, have led this race from start to finish at the moment, of course, but it looks as though that's the way it will now end. The Histor team coming home to finish. They're outside already the time of Panasonic. Stephen Roach, Ryan Holm in the champion of Denmark jersey there. The riders bunching together because the time will stop on the fifth rider to cross the line. As you can see when you watch the clock, it stopped now, 53-46. Second place for Histor. So it's a good, strong finish for Stephen Roach, because disregard the Bauer situation, he has done better than most of the favourites.
Well, he has. They've come in over the last 15 kilometres extremely strongly, because they were never doing very well at the intermediary time, so they must have really gone well over the last 10-15 kilometres while the other teams were starting to crack up a little bit. And we go back down here to the Castorama Rally team.
Well, Laurent Fignon, he's known himself what it's like to struggle in a team time trial in the past. And the question is he okay after that crash in the Tour of Italy, which eventually led to him giving up? He says himself he's not 100% fit yet, but he's hoping to ride himself in. Well, today is not the day to ride yourself into the race with this wind blowing. He's number 11 on the far right of our picture, and it looks as though he's still working in the group as well. Seems too, Paul, as though all 9 men are here. They haven't lost anybody.
Well, they haven't lost anybody at all, as they can't be very far from the finish now, maybe 1.5 kilometres to go. And then maybe they'll produce a surprise as well, because the teams who've been coming in towards the end here, they've improved a great deal, probably because they've been getting advice from their team managers of how hard the last 15-20 kilometres is. So they've been starting slowly and pulling back the time over the last half of the course.
Well, it's certainly picked out the strong men on this race. Steve Bauer is going to be a good leader, I think, because if anything, this wind is getting even stronger over this last half an hour. starting at the back of the group now is Pascal Simon, once led the Tour de France and one of the few riders ever to retire when wearing the leader's yellow jersey. He crashed and broke a shoulder blade, then continued for a number of days before finally he had to give up. And this is the team that this morning had Thierry Marie in yellow. And what a surprise it was that he isn't still in yellow, because really, with a team like Castorama, they were the team that could have kept Thierry Marie in yellow in this team time trial. There's Fignon, and it looks to me, Paul, as though he is struggling.
Well, Fignon always looks to be struggling these days, especially in team time trials. He used to be one of the strongest riders in this kind of effort. He used to be one of the best time trialists in the world, but he seems to have lost a little bit in that quarter recently. However, when it comes to panache and aggression, knowing how to attack when they come to the mountains, Fignon hasn't lost that. So he's not finished, but I think towards the end of his career, he's changing his tactics a little bit.
Well, over to our right there, you can see the buildings of Futuroscope. And again, no further confirmation of any changes. PDM, yes, PDM have come up here in the second place. They've nipped over Omstey. So Sean Kelly's team are doing a very good ride, losing only 10 seconds to Panasonic at the 36-kilometre point. So this is interesting, because Sean Kelly is saying that he wants to challenge for the yellow jersey in this year's Tour de France. But just to the right shoulder of the Castorama team is the hotel they're staying in tonight. But now they've got to go on the long, steady climb up towards the finishing line before they get the chance of a very, very, very welcome hot shower indeed. This has been a long, hard day for the riders in these conditions. Although the sun is now shining, in fact, it's been quite cold as well. The only good news is that the threat storms haven't materialized. Still trying to force the pace, Christophe Levin, number 13. Thierry Marie goes through on his shoulder. Marie's on the left of our picture now. He won the prologue yesterday. He's now trying to bring the team up to the finishing line. They're all anxious now to get the best time out of this they can. It's going to keep them right up amongst the leaders here. 53 minutes. It might just go to 54, but it's good enough for them. And so the Castorama rally team are in. 53 minutes, 57 seconds, and that is the fourth best time. Just one team now left out on the course, Sean Kelly's PDM team, which is tremendously strong this year, with Raul Alcala and also Eric Breking. Here they are, there indeed, too, is Raul Alcala. Kelly's number 37.
Maybe a well-timed effort by the PDM team, because we haven't seen any reference to them all the way through the intermediary times there, and they may well have got some very good advice from the team managers to know exactly what the circuit's like today, exactly what the finish is like, because I think the weather has changed a little bit towards the end, and maybe they're going to take advantage of a slight drop in the wind.
Well, this is a great mixture of talent, this team, because it has Dutchmen, Mexicans, two East Germans, an Irishman, a Belgian on this team, and yet they get on so well together. The catalyst is Jan Gispers, their team manager. He selects riders not just for the strength, but because of their personality as well. And Raul Alcala, Sean Kelly, Eric Breking are the riders who will be expected to do their job in the Tour de France this year. And it does appear they've only come onto the leaderboard at the penultimate check. And that means that they could well be coming strong as they come to the finish. The 7-Eleven certainly have been the best team over these last kilometres. They have survived to keep Steve Bauer in that leader's yellow jersey. There's Raul Alcala, we just caught a glimpse of him there. They're the team who are extremely annoyed about the escape this morning of those four riders. They were the only team that wanted to take up the chase, and for a while they limited the escape of those four men, and then found they were receiving no help at all for the rest of the race, so they stopped chasing. The result was an enormous gap that's gone out to over 10 minutes. So the last team then, making its way up to Futuroscope. The Science Theme Park here, just outside Poitiers, that has welcomed the Tour de France for the weekend, and what a hard weekend it's been. But I don't suppose that Steve Bauer will be complaining. Pedro Delgado not losing quite so much time at the end of the opening days as he did a year ago, but he's still conceding time to Greg LeMond. Laurent Fignon is also going to go out on the road to Nantes with a big time gap over Greg LeMond, and nothing insurmountable, but the gaps are already opening. It could be a very, very good Tour de France, this. And just look at these riders now at the back, scrambling for wheels. And then if they ease and drop off, it won't be so important as long as their strong men, Breking, Kelly and Alcala, are finishing in the first five who get the time to the individual classification. Riders who drop off get a different time, of course. You can just see for the first time the climb that they do face up to the finish. We're sitting right on top of the hill as they now open up the sprint for the finish. And look at this, it's going to be tight, it's going to be very tight. The clock is counting on the fifth man, and that might cost them the victory. It's gone, but the PDM team will not be far away. They'll take second place here, ever so close to Panasonic, 53 minutes and 31 seconds. So Sean Kelly's PDM team finished second in the team time trial. But there is no doubt that tonight the overall lead will stay on the shoulders of the Canadian rider Steve Bauer.
So here's the result of the team time trial, a win for Panasonic. In second place, Sean Kelly's PDM squad. And a surprise in third slot, the Once team from Spain. Stephen Roach in fourth place with the Histor boys. And in fifth slot, you've got Laurent Fignon's Castorama rally squad. Overall, there was no change in the end. Steve Bauer has consolidated in that leader's yellow jersey. And in second place, Franz Massen, his team couldn't quite get the better of the 7-Eleven boys. The other two riders in the breakaway fill third and fourth places overall. Significantly though, all four many minutes ahead of the rest of the field. Well, if you receive Fortel on your television, you can see the full results service on page 465. The Tour de France now has ended here in Futuroscope, and we're off downtown to Poitiers tomorrow, where the race will begin the long road to Paris. We're heading off on tomorrow's stage from Poitiers to Nantes. I hope you'll now follow the Tour de France with us as we move around France. You can see us again, day three, tomorrow night on Channel 4 at 6:30. Until then, it's goodbye.